Persona 3 FES. This video is not going to be so much a review like the other videos recently put out, but more of a talking point, discussing what I thought about Persona 3, and why I decided to play Persona 3 despite Persona 5 being released in 2017. There may be spoilers involved, so bear with me, and we'll see where my brain decides to go. I suppose I'll start with where I come from when it comes to the Persona series. The only game I've played before is Persona 4, years ago on my PS2, and I loved every second of it. To the style, to the characters, the music, commanding gameplay difficulty, to the themes, to the symbolism I'm still learning about today with looking at different write-ups and other things like that, to making me goddamn cry after everything was done, Persona 4 is definitely one of my top 10 favorite games ever. I've certainly been interested in playing other games in the series since then, but until now, I've not been able to budget my time well enough in order to dive into another 100-plus hour adventure. Seeing as 2017 has been the year of Persona 5 for many people, I considered starting to play it, since I do have it, and that did not happen. Instead, I took a different direction, as I tend to do. Never the popular decision, huh? I wanted to go backwards and see where Persona 4 came from and play Persona 3. Note that there is a lot of Persona 3 I still do not know about, specifically all the stuff that Persona 3 Portable provides, or going into detail about anything revolving, well, anything. Personally, I think it was a good decision to play Persona 3 before jumping into Persona 5. I see Persona 3 as a foundational game for the series. Persona 1 and 2 are kind of in their own world, a world I would love to experience someday too. But having the experience of playing Persona 4 definitely colors my experience with Persona 3. Persona 3 was a game changer for the series, changing the style of Persona, which can definitely be seen in 4, and certainly from what I've seen in 5. The other thing about Persona 3 being a foundational game is that not only can it be seen as innovative to the RPG genre, but that there is another side, making a double-edged sword situation. The negative, of course, is being the backwards comparison from playing any of the future titles. You can see the negative space that Persona 3 has that could be filled, which I'm sure Portable tried to do later, but playing FES, it comes at you in droves. In Persona 4, there is a lot of organization involved in the time you have in order to see almost everything in a single playthrough, especially social links, and can be done, with few free days for yourself. Persona 5, apparently it is even harder, requiring incredible micromanagement skills on your part. In comparison, Persona 3 is now a pretty light RPG when it comes to organizational skills on your part. The biggest thing I found organizing time is how often you go to Tartarus, the main dungeon, and arguably the gameplay in Persona 3, and when I reached November, I had the next 2 months to reach the end of the fifth block. And even I found that to be too much time in order to get that done. There is only so much you can traverse in Tartarus, fighting the bosses, which are a mix between challenging, fun to learn, to downright gimmicky and stupid to fight, before you become sick of ascending or grinding once you've finished your goal. What I'm trying to say is that you can pretty much take as much time as possible to get through Tartarus during the time you have before the next story beat, unless you are really into finishing the requests from Elizabeth. The other organizational problem with Persona 3 is the balance between the daytime activities and the nighttime activities. Eventually, you just run out of things to do during the night. Increasing your stats and social links and going out becomes almost meaningless once you've raised all your stats to max, unless you wish to level up your Persona stats. I decided that was better than nothing, but that also took away from the difficulty of the battles just a little bit. And the fights can be difficult at times. Persona is another RPG series that requires that you think about every turn you make, because you never know what the enemy might do next, and how unlucky you might be. To turn the difficulty up a little bit as well, you have only control of the main character and your party is AI controlled, and you will get mad at them from time to time. I don't remember using the tactics option as much as I have in this game than others, in order to change what skills and enemies are more important to use and focus on respectively for a certain fight. Of course, it's not perfect, like characters using single-target abilities instead of multi-target, and vice versa, and never using their buff and debuff abilities ever. It just felt like you had to be more prepared for a fight as a single person, and be more versatile compared to Persona 4, where you had the option of controlling your entire party, which I have never seen anybody not do. Now, the thing I have glossed over while discussing whatever I've been discussing is the story of Persona 3. And maybe this is because I don't want to spoil it, or maybe it is because my discussing the story also makes me discuss the answer as well, which is such a point of contention with the Persona 3 community, especially in the case of whether or not it's good canon or that it ruins the story of Persona 3 altogether. Also, the fact that it does not take into account Persona 3 Portable, as there's the female protagonist, so it is not written in a way that accepts that. So, let's talk about the main story. Otherwise known as The Journey, it is a fine story, and I find that the story's strongest features come from what is not said, its subtlety, and the weight the characters eventually carry can be felt toward the end. So why is it that the characters are not held in the same regard? I find that comes from each character not having a decent arc surrounding them. Some of them hit it right out of the park, like you know they belong in Persona 3, they're interwoven into the story. It's just that some of the characters are interwoven better than others. Some characters' arcs are briefly introduced in a specific day, sit around for a while, and wait until all the characters involved in the arc get together so that they can resolve their issues in some way. I'm talking about you, Ken. There is just so much more opportunity for digging deeper into characters that is just not there. As a simple negative, again, there's a lot of empty space in FES. However, that empty space is also kind of a positive when it comes to the overall story. The waiting, with little happening, actually contributes to that story, especially during the final months and the decision point of the game. Remember when I was talking about the 2-month period to clear out the rest of Tartarus? Well, the latter month involves the decision point. One of the main themes of Persona 3 is death, and also life at the same point, which is contemplated heavily throughout the month by each character, and how they want to deal with it from their own perspectives. And during that month, there is very little for you to do, other than go through day-to-day, your regular schedule, occasionally go to Tartarus when you can, like nothing's different, like nothing's changed. And I found that quite powerful. Not at first, but eventually the date of the decision point looms over you. It gets closer and closer. Everybody comes to their own terms, their resolve gets settled, a new bond is formed, and you move towards ending the game. It's quite a moment. So then the ending happens, and then Persona 3, the answer, happens right after that. And I've looked at a lot of different opinions surrounding this epilogue to Persona 3. Most say avoid it. Some say that it's terrible. Some also say that it ruins the character development that Persona 3 built. And honestly, I agree with a lot of those opinions. There are some strange and risky decisions that the answer decides to go for, and I do want to give my 2 cents on an epilogue that will easily take another 35 hours away from you if you're willing to play it. The question, is it good, is really not the question to ask with the answer, though, as I feel that it takes away from what it tries to do, because the simple answer would be, no, it isn't good. But I can't simply dismiss the answer, so let's break it down. I certainly appreciate some things that it tries to do. 1. The difficulty. I appreciated the challenge that the answer brings to the table. It warns when you start that it expects you to have played the journey beforehand, because you will hate yourself with how hard it will be for you. It also makes you think about the enemies you want to fight in each block explore, because there are more than a few fights that are simply throwing boss level enemies at you with no weaknesses, lots of health, and there are usually 3 at a time. The difficulty's not only in the battles either. You don't have a lot of things available to you like you do in the journey, especially the Velvet Room. The only thing you can do in the Velvet Room is fuse personas. That's it. No compendium, no requests, no other bonuses that you might get, nothing like that. That means that your skill loadout is reliant on what personas you get out of shuffle time fighting enemies. What you do with them is up to you. Either level them up normally, fighting enemies, or fuse them for something possibly better. The only downside is that there are no social links in the answer either. Therefore, whatever you fuse will receive no experience bonuses. Everything begins at its base level, and you are forced to level up your personas through combat, which, after a while, I did not mind. It might be me being complacent, honestly, or just adjusting to the resources that are given to me, but it all depends on your mindset again. Depending on your mindset and what I've just mentioned, this may not feel like a Persona game at all. And it's true. The answer is missing a lot of what makes a Persona game a Persona game. Instead, they decided to make an endurance run of an RPG that tests your wits and confidence in your own abilities. 2. How it decides to continue the story. I'm just going to put huge spoilers in here, by the way. Anyway, welcome back to the Unpopular Opinions Corner with me. Yay! Anyway, here's another unpopular opinion from me. I did not really like the ending of Persona 3 as much as I thought I would. The final boss was super cool and has a great gimmick to it that is also used in the answer, but it is the scenes afterward that still bug me a little, which luckily the answer provides, you know, an answer to what actually happens during the ending. I still like the final playable bit before the credits though. Seeing all the people you met and established bonds with, especially with the ones that left afterwards, still felt very good, very heartwarming. But during this section, the game insinuates something is going to happen, but does not actually state it. And that, according to the answer, is the protagonist dies at the end in Aegis's lap. This is because he practically used his entire life force, also being tied to death himself by partly housing Ryoji Pharos / Nyx inside of him, in order to create a seal so that Nyx does not annihilate the world. This means that the main character is not in the answer. Well, not really, but the main character actually turns out to be Aegis instead. You control Aegis in the answer. I found it cool that they decided to make a voice character with the wildcard ability and be able to speak to Igor in the Velvet Room, having an actual two-way conversation. I haven't seen it done before. As well as be aware that the protagonist had access to there the entire time. That's also great. There are bits in Persona 3 where characters question the main character just standing weirdly in one spot in a daze. And that's kind of taken care of in the answer. The answer's story also gives us the answer to what became of the protagonist, who serves as a seal not for Nyx, which was assumed, but as a seal for the harbinger of Nyx, which is all the negative thoughts wishing for death turned into the being Erebus, which, damn, he is a difficult final boss. That took me a few hours to finally get him down. But I think the main thing I like about the story of the answer is that it calls itself the answer. It makes you think immediately about what the answer could be too. What is the question? And the answer gets a little philosophical in this area, because not only does it answer about what the protagonist becomes, but also repeatedly returns to the dominant themes in Persona 3, life and death. You will listen to characters asking about the answer to life, but it does not necessarily have to be about that either. In a rather cop-out way, the answer can be to whatever you want, like possibly to the future of the characters, to where they go from here, or plenty of other questions that can come up from playing the epilogue. But the story is not all that great, so let's mention that a little bit. The story does not have a whole lot of detail to justify the roughly 35-hour extension to the story. It's one of the biggest problems of the answer, to be honest. It's the structure. In order to progress to the next story bit, you need to descend through another block of the Abyss of Time, which is similar to Tartarus, just kind of the opposite way around. Instead of going up, you're going down. After a certain amount of floors, you encounter a boss. But difficulty being a big thing in the answer, you have to face the boss in the current condition you reach the floor in. So if you have little to no SP, you will stand little chance, and you might as well recall back to the start of the section and beeline right back down with a full health and SP bar. There's a lot of wasted time in that regard. But it also means that you're able to grind up enough levels so that you are suitable for finding the next boss. Which, as I now just said that, is the worst way to put it. Having a structure that punishes you until you're the designated level in order to continue. Not good. I don't think so, anyway. Once you get to the bottom of the block, which can be up to two bosses later, and up to three sections of around 9 floors later, you will reach a flashback of one of the characters. Now, repeat this 7 times. All the while, similar questions are being asked ad nauseam, with Fuka stammering so much and she can't speak her mind and get out the obvious thing in the room if you would just look at the screen. My god, woman, get the ball rolling. Why do I even bother? So with that, I want to talk about the characters as well. Arguably, the messiest part of the answer. I will praise Persona 3 for its gradual progression of characters throughout the story, ultimately leading to a satisfying end when they find the resolve to face death head-on. Some characters throw that aside in the answer, and to the game's credit, it is acted upon when its major decision decides to happen. But the problem seems to be that it shouldn't have happened. You think an incredible epiphany like potentially sacrificing yourself for a chance to save the world would stay with you. But nope, some characters would rather undo all they did, all they achieved, for selfish reasons. Some are in character though, such as Mitsuru, who follows Yukari, whom I think had the biggest change for the answer, because of the understandable character development where Yukari brought Mitsuru back from the loss of her father and strengthened her resolve by being there for her. So naturally, Mitsuru would have Yukari's back in order to return the favor. I'm fine with that. In fact, now that I'm thinking about it, the characters are really in there for a primary selfish reason in the answer. They're just trying to get out, and would go to any means in order to do that. When they're given multiple options, they look at their options and they're looking desperate. That's what some characters react to anyways. Some keep their heads and think a little bit harder about their whole situation. Thank you, Junpei, you are pretty awesome. Which leads to that one section of the answer that really takes this point home. The Battle Royale. I'll be honest, I was looking forward to this point in the answer, especially when it was part of the opening sting when you start the game entirely, as well as when you start the answer. But the answer brings it down pretty hard when you look at what the characters become. I don't want to think that the characters were purposefully changed in order to make this part work, but it is not that off base. Again, Yukari's the one who does the biggest change, and she acts like a downright villain in the answer. Reaching the end of the answer, you find out how to get out of where you are, which requires the group to make a decision. The decision crumbles in this case, and everyone takes sides. In order to get out, you need to take down the rest of the group in order to make your decision the true decision that cannot be changed or refuted. I thought it was a cool idea to begin with, but I was actually wanting the section to be over with quickly because, one, I knew what had to be done and what the outcome was going to be. Obviously, you have to win. And two, there was not any weight to it. I don't know how to explain it, but despite the connections I developed with the characters over the course of 100 hours of Persona 3, I didn't feel like I was fighting them, almost like fake or caricature-like versions of them. The characters I knew and grew to like were not really in the answer a whole lot, so my emotional weight was missing. Except for Koromaru. I hated fighting him. There was no fun there. Now, there is one thing I've neglected to mention throughout my one-way discussion of the answer. One character that is introduced in the answer that accompanies you through the abyss of time and also tries to kill you. Metis. But I actually have very little to say about Metis because of how she's handled. I had this whole write-up for her as well, including how the character's reactions to her can mirror your own, which is pretty cool, and how you learn, like, who she truly is versus, like, Aegis as well. But then I remembered that she doesn't exist. There's only one true toaster, except no substitutes. I really don't know whether to recommend the answer or not. Play Persona 3, obviously. But the answer will come down to whether or not you enjoy the challenge stemming from restrictions, or you cannot stand how much the story may betray the enjoyment you had in Persona 3. It is quite a conflicting piece. And now, personally, I wonder where to go with my Persona adventures from here. As I'm conflicted with either going further backward with Persona 2, starting with Eternal Punishment, because I keep thinking about it over and over and over, or going forward with Persona 5. From what I've seen of 5, they do take bits from Persona 2, like talking with the demons in order to recruit them. Oh well, who knows? I'll make a decision eventually. Oh boy, wow. You made it to the end of this Persona jargon. I'm honestly glad I was able to play this and get through it by the end of the year, and I hope that I can continue my Persona journey sooner rather than later. There are a lot of things I missed, obviously, that I could have talked about, but I know with just looking for other channels that there is probably someone who is more eloquent than I to be talking about Persona. However, if you did kind of enjoy this kind of discussion here, you can also look at my unpopular opinion on Super Mario 3D Land, a game that I did not enjoy playing in 2017, as well as a whole bunch of other games that I played during 2017. If you enjoyed this video, clicking a button or two is hard, I know, but just remember to come back every so often to see if I have more videos up. My schedule for videos releasing is inconsistent, and my quality is questionable at best, I know. So I'll leave it in your hands whether or not to subscribe or like or whatever. I'll keep trying with new things and continue to improve from here. That's all I can do. Take care, everyone.